So, my name is Tatiana Bazzichelli. I'm the curator of the Resource for Transmedial Culture. And today we are starting a day of the Resource Trial Track program. And I'm happy to introduce the first panel that is named Sustainable Disruption. And is moderated by Oliver Lerone Schulz and Clemens Aprich. And we have also a long program today, but I think I will introduce this briefly time to time. And since we are a bit late, I would already start with your panel.
Yeah, actually the idea is that we split up the discussion in two parts, two by two presentations. And the first part is actually moderated by Clemens.
It works.
So testen.
Brauchen wir das überhaupt?
Do we need it?
Yeah, because we
have. So welcome everybody. Maybe for those who haven't been here yesterday, why Oliver and I have the pleasure here to moderate the panel is because we are invited as the Post Media Lab from Lüneburg. There's also Timon over there, who is like the head of the whole thing there. And actually, that's also the reason why Rasa is joining us. She just came from Riga and is leaving today again for Riga. So it's one-stop visit to Berlin, because Rasa at the moment is one of the research fellows at the Post Media Lab in Lüneburg, and we are very happy to have her here. And Philipp, I will introduce him later when we come to his presentation. Just shortly about Rasa, as I said, she's at the moment a visiting fellow at the Post Media Lab in Lüneburg, and she has been involved quite a lot into the net cultures and new media art since the 1990s. She also did research and still does research on network cultures. She's one of the founders of the eLab in Riga, that was 1996, and then also of the Rixi Media Lab in 2000. She's also one of the organizers of the annual Art and Communication Festival, which is going on since also 1996. And we also have still some copies here of the little festival catalog book they produce. So as the idea was also to use this panel a little bit to that we can talk about your projects mainly, I would like just to begin with Rasa, that she may become, sorry, that you mainly can talk a bit about what the eLab was and what the Rixi Media Center still is. We're switching to the presentation here. Because we also did once, I mean, I know Rasa for quite a long time, and we also did an interview not long time ago where we talked about this kind of switch between the more or less 90s cultures, where there was this typical idea of an e-lab and a lot of traveling and more into kind of a virtual space reality. And I think it's quite interesting for this context here, where we're talking a lot about local resources and grounded net cultures, that the Rixi was actually founded in this kind of new reasons and motivation to really ground it more into the local scene of Riga. And maybe you could talk a little bit about this shift and the reasons, the motivation, and then what Rixi actually stands for.
Okay, so I will again say shortly who I am, what I am. I am a new media artist, have been working with emerging media technologies since mid-90s, but I'm also a curator and organizer of different digital art events, exhibitions, and festivals. And I'm also a network researcher, and recently I have written and defended my PhD on network cultures. The title of my PhD was Creative Communities. And this introduction is just because my position was for writing also my PhD and doing this. I didn't do it in an arts context, actually. It was in sociology where I defended it. So because I wanted to show the position from inside, how it is being involved in the new media culture since the 90s from inside, and how it is possible to reflect it from the today's position. So this was mainly like my about my thesis. And what I would like to to say. One thing is, of course, that how we started in '90s. Then we were a group of young artists who wanted to find something else beyond that time contemporary arts scene, which was curated by Soros Foundation and also by curators of contemporary arts centers. This was mainly what was happening at that time in Eastern Europe, in all places. And Latvia, after the fall of the Berlin Wall, was also such place. There was no funding for arts. There was nearly nothing, actually. And this emptiness provoked us young artists that time to seek for what else is possible to do. Personally, I was very much interested in something new. What could be much more interesting than doing contemporary arts, which basically at that time people were just like repeating what Western artists have been doing, in Latvia at least. And we first heard about the internet in 1995. We visited Tallinn's conference, Interstanding, in 1995. And then we met first, like, for first time, some of net culture young gurus that time, like Gert Loving and Richard Barbuk and Alexei Shulgin. And then we had such a big psychological barrier just to make a step and to start to talk to them, that we also are interested in this, because we were thinking that something probably already like this is happening out there. I don't know, but in Riga we don't have even internet and also not email connection. So basically, in the middle of the nowhere, in the cultural situation when a previous system was not anymore functioning, yeah, Soviet system. In the mid-90s, it was very like open space for younger generation to bring in different also subculture, like techno culture, club culture, like science from the West, and to adapt into local context. And the same also was happening in arts. And our first visions about the art was that, so these are some pictures from the 90s, our manifesto of eLab. I don't know if it's possible to read. So, but basically, we were very happy about this virtual space, which was internet, that we don't have to deal with any local problems or in any politics and any situations. And we were dreaming maybe about in such a utopian way that it's even not anymore important to live in metropolis. We can simply be based in Riga and participate in global networks. And we initiated the internet radio project called Exchange, which involved many local sound artists initiatives from the world, really from different also other remote places, like Banff, Canada, but Ljubljana, and also very active people from Australia were involved. So we just had to connect time zones when we did our collaborative experimentations. And what was happening with this Exchange network? In 1998, when Pete Schultz organized Net Radio Days in Berlin here for first time, also this Exchange mailing list was used to coordinate this event. And then even an article appeared in a German computer technique, I think, magazine, that Riga is the epicentrum of the global internet radio. So this is something for us. No, we didn't really even were dreaming about it. So this was the situation. But then being already known in an international circle of network of internet culture, we realized that nobody knows eLab in Riga. And this was our turn why we started to think of joint effort and to build up another infrastructure. And in 2000, we founded RIXI. Because also the another issue was that we had just a tiny small lab in the fifth floor of like a space, a local space for our eLab in Artist Union House. But this was important for us to have such a lab that time. Of course, nobody really had at home computers then. But we wanted also to run our own like public events space, and that's why. Also, we started negotiations with the Artists Union, and we rented for many years, called RIXI Media Space. It was a former cultural sculpture studio, not very big space, about 110 square meters, exactly a good size for Riga, but and with very high ceilings, 8 meters, so it was nice place for performance events and also conferences we have held there. And so this networking was very active in 90s, and then we started to more go into the local things and really work actively locally. But another turn was going away from networking was when Latvia joined the EU, and economical growth started in Latvia, and it was more it was possible some things like which were not before. So we could organize also very large-scale exhibitions, and mainly with even national funding. We organized one exhibition called Waves, Electromagnetic Waves as Material and Medium in Arts, together with Armin Medos, curator and writer from Austria. And and this was also for first time in 2006 when we made such a large manifestation of new media art in Riga. It was in National Arts Museum. There is about nearly 2,000 square meters space. It was filled with 40 artworks. And we were thinking that economy will go like this forever. And in 2008, we organized another similar exhibition called Spectropia, Artistic and Scientific Investigations into Electromagnetic Spectrum. Latvia announced that we are nearly bankrupt, and all fundings which were already confirmed for RICSI for the year 2009 were simply cancelled. So we basically started, we spent all our reserves to pay for this exhibition, and we started from the zero year 2009. And again, we were thinking that we need networking.
A little question on that one, because you of course about the context of media cultures, and coming from Vienna, it was always this kind of accusation: if you're doing something with internet, you don't need an office, you don't need physical spaces. So if you're in digital media, you don't need physical spaces. Because in 2000, when you founded RICSI, what kind of strategies did you have? Because we were talking yesterday about also artistic unions, and you just mentioned that you made some kind of union pressure group. How did that work in that way?
First of all, our strategy in 90s, because we were really big utopians, we were thinking that ELAB never will grow bigger. It has to be small, everything has to be heterogeneous as possible. So instead we encouraged all other active people to establish their own organization. So basically by year 2000, there was interesting digital and contemporary culture scene with small organizations. And we came all together, and we decided, like kind of in the big meeting, that let's establish the Center for New Media Culture, and especially New Media Culture, not only arts, because there were also different other groups joining, and also internet discourse was not like a dominant in Latvia. It was more about like different type of cultures being involved, from contemporary arts to DJ scene to multimedia presentations through poetical and literature readings, like different types of cultures of younger generation.
Good, that's like a way to maybe move on and introducing Philipp Horst. He's one of the co-founders of the art collective Kunstrepublik that was founded in 2006. And he's also curator, artist and researcher at the Skulpturenpark Zentrum Berlin, which is not far, we will explain it where exactly it's situated. And there's even a nice catalog I was allowed to download. I'm not sure if it's like free for everybody, but there's a really nice catalog like dealing with the Skulpturenpark Berlin Zentrum. And he's also co-founder of the ZKU, here it's printed. This is the Center for Art and Urbanistic in Berlin Wedding, or is it in Moabit, and this one is actually opening this summer, and I think we will talk a bit about this later. But first of all, I would be interested in if you could explain a little bit this kind of connection relation between the art collective Kunstrepublik and Skulpturenpark, because if you read all these kind of concept papers and everything, it seems to me that there are a lot of hidden maneuvers and about hidden operations you're doing there, like strategy of multiple names.
Yeah, my name is Philipp, and I'm one of five. So Kunstrepublik is a collective of five men. The other names are Matze, Harry, Markus, and Dan. And it's true, we have many, maybe many faces, not so many names, but we appear in different situations. We appear underneath a different umbrella. Skulpturenpark is a name of a place, and so to say of a project, because it has, it's maybe temporary, it's still going on, and it will also go on when there are buildings. Maybe I put together a few images. We could start this PDF. Was it here? No. Changed. Desktop. Philip. Here. PDF. Okay. So Skulpturenpark mainly is a place kind of really in the center of Berlin. Here you can see the Spittelmarkt, and on the south it's Moritzplatz. So in between Spittelmarkt and Moritzplatz is, at that time when we started working there, 2006, a large empty lot, as you can see on the picture. But now there have been a few activities by real estate companies to build houses. So in the time when we started to work with this space, it was looking like this. And we had a studio here, and we're always looking down on the site, and like walking down, you can see the fences, and it was a very normal view you had in Berlin, like walking along abandoned and sometimes fenced off, sometimes not fenced off, empty lots. So we were having a studio there for a few years, and we always thought, why is it so large and not used since 16 years? And especially we were wondering, why is no one really using it? So it was cut off by fences, and so we started to investigate a little bit about the owner structures. So what you can see here is that there, even though if it's all an empty space, it is still, like in the administration, it is dealt with singular plots. And when we researched about 25 owners, and by the time, like 2 years ago when we last did update, it was 8 owners, so the time since 2006 lowered down. So there was a lot of speculation going on, like buying plots and bringing them together. So what we did was, we were interested in revealing different contexts of the sites, and did projects ourselves or invited others to do so. And I just picked a few. So the only remaining thing actually on the place was this billboard, and the billboard was going alongside many, many other billboards, because besides speculation, this was the only kind of income for the owners, to rent it to advertisement companies. But anyways, the price was very low, because the place, it's kind of abandoned, and even though it's in the center, not many passerby. It's not like Potsdamer Platz. So projects happening there, they were all temporary, so starting from like maybe 2 hours up to 3 years. And some were really sculptural in a sense, so working with the material, with the space, like the project here from Volker and Martin, Körbeling Kaltwasser. They made a sculpture from the sculpture park, and digged 3 holes, and were kind of quoting the situation which was there before the wall came down. There were platforms looking from the west over to the east, and they were all over the city. And they were kind of inverting this situation. So instead of going up and looking over something, they go down and find yourself in the ground. And on the other way, it's also like opposing this strategy of real investment companies to build a showroom or the big box on Potsdamer Platz where you could see the construction site and see the future from above. So here you go down into the history. And what they found was remaining building cellars, intact doors. So it was also a dig into history. I will have about 5 projects to show you. This is a piece by Etienne Boulanger, and he was also working with what is there. I told you before about all the billboards, so he was putting the billboards together to form a box, so from 6 billboards. And inside, you could climb underneath this box and have a ladder which can be removed and have a door and enter a full-equipped 2-star hotel room. And this was rented out for 5 months to visitors. So the only accessibility was for the opening and for the finissage. And you had to book it, which was €20 a night. And instead of having windows, we had the advertisement, which was also partly funding the construction of the building of this. Ulrike Mohr brought new neighbors to the Skulpturenpark. Just before, this is on the roof of the Palast der Republik, before they started to take it down, she was saving 5 trees which have been grown wild on the roof, and had them for some time in a tree school, Baumschule, to get the roots from their very flat, because they were only growing on this concrete, to get them really like be ready to go in Mother Soil, Mother Earth, and planted them on Skulpturenpark. And the similarity between the very symbolic Palast der Republik for the contemporary Berlin and the Skulpturenpark was that the new neighbors had exactly the same age, because both institutions, Palast der Republik and the wall area, fell off function in 1989 or 1990. So they had the same age, and you could only differ them by these signs she mounted. Another kind of strategy by Valeska Peschke, and he didn't come alone. It was also a tribute to all the pioneers using the Skulpturenpark Berlin Zentrum, the people with their dogs, because the dogs need that open space, and in compared to like a normal park, you have to have your leash, like legally, and on the Skulpturenpark you can let them run and play. You see them here gathering at the sculpture. And this is a reference, and also the interesting story behind this. This is a Toro, which is, it was a advertisement from Osborne, a liquor company. And they started in the 60s to place all these toros in the landscape of Spain. And then in the 80s, there was a law forbidding all advertisement near autostrada, like streets. And everyone had to take down the advertisement. And then there were local like initiatives, national initiatives to save the toro, because it became the national symbol of Spain. And so there was these groups made it happen that there's a law now which allows the toro to remain in the landscape, because it's now a cultural reminiscence, like cultural object for Spain. But the Osborne had to remove all the naming and wording about their company. But from the symbol, it remained. It's a piece by Matze Einhoff, and he was like taking the situation of Skulpturenpark, this usage, like the dog owners using the space, but there are also other groups. There's in Berlin, there's this term Zwischennutzer, so people using the in-between usage, in between the manifestation of a building, probably with real estate, and the time before it was something else. And they're all different groups, like, which is now very popular, urban gardeners, but also skateboarders and BMXler and so on. And Matze worked with some of these groups and developed like a kind of flag with them and a hymn. So what you could see in the beginning, these poles with the flags were all individual, relating to individual groups. And here you can see the pulling up the flag with the hymn. And there was a second attachment, this tribune. And for every group, they had like a sentence, a special slogan. And you can see them here coming up. Like the hymn is playing, the flag is moving, and the audience is showing the slogan, and it's changing for all the 12 initiatives taking part in this ceremony. Yeah, and then a big happening was happening on Skulpturenpark Berlin Zentrum. Before we were like more private, we had like our openings were attending between 10 and 200 or 300 visitors, but then the Berlin Biennial number 5 was approaching us because they were interested in doing something on Skulpturenpark Berlin Zentrum, because it was fitting in their curatorial concept to move between a Western and the Eastern institution. We were the kind of off or in-between space for them, and we made a deal with them that they create a show on the Skulpturenpark Berlin Zentrum. So it was also some work to keep the name up, because I wanted to give it a new name, but then it was name of Skulpturenpark in collaboration with Kunstrepublik. And suddenly we had, I don't know, 60,000 people going around the site. And it's also interesting, we have some quotes from press, because it was a very unarty space, especially to walk and to find the sculptures. But we also did one piece, one image missing, one night piece for the Berlin Biennial, and used the VIP cars. BMW was one of the main sponsors, only for the VIPs. And we use these cars to tow them together, so they're all connected, have them drive in circles like a carousel, and playing from like simultaneously from the radio, "This Land Is Your Land." Maybe you remember this song. "This land is your land, this land is my land." And for the length of a song, cars were moving, then they stopped, and people could get in and out. So it was became a public carousel. What about time? Yeah, can I go on? I mean, just quickly look, what else do I have? Yeah, okay. So maybe,
we're coming to that one.
I want just to like just lead, like, yeah, dramatically. Yeah.
Not just a quick question on that one, because I mean, you talked now about this kind of what's in German the Unort of Skulpturenpark, which is the non-place actually, and even the name is a quite not very fancy. I mean, Skulpturenpark Zentrum Berlin, and there's a very nice article in the catalog written by Susanne Schröder, where she also has this kind of historical overview of Skulpturenparks. And normally, if you think about this, it's more this kind of place where you can stroll around. The contemplation side, it's for the bourgeois who can enjoy and so on. And this would be the one side. But on the other side, I mean, even if you're looking about some kind of, since the 90s, reappropriation strategies, you know, like taking back the privatized public spaces, even that one, for me, doesn't even fit, because, I mean, you don't even, what is there to reappropriate? Because there is nothing. So I find, could you maybe tell also about this last project, and which kind of in this post-industrial city, as you also labeled it, what kind of strategies are there in there to use this kind of non-place for what exactly? So what resources are in there?
I think for us it was we understood or understand ourselves more like a commentator on the space, so not so much we don't have a special like aim or target to become something. So I think the least thing we would like to have is like a real Skulpturenpark, like the, as you mentioned it, there's a, where you have passes and signs telling you about the sculptures. I think we were interested in like showing different possibility of a space and of a situation. And also, it's not a public space, it's a private space, which also made many things easy for us. Mostly we didn't ask the owners what we do, because they were not there anyway. Sometimes we did, and for example, for the dog piece, it was refused, because when they got to know that we want to put up a dog, they said, no, but then there are more dog owners coming, so they're... But maybe to end this, it's maybe also a good example of like imagining a future space, because we also, like you can see in the catalog, there was, like with the opening of the Berlin Biennial, there was an investor coming from Holland, a Dutch investor, and he wanted to make Skulpturenpark Berlin Zentrum to become the Italian Quarter of Berlin. So if you think of Mafia, maybe different way, it should look like Rome and have the feeling of easy life going on. But he was developing luxury apartments with a very, very high price, so also quite new for Berlin. And he built a little showroom. And as a contextualization of that, how a future might look like if the Italian Quarter will develop, a survival group from France, they opened up their collections. They took in Paris, mainly in Paris, of so-called anti-sites or anti-sites, which are, like you can see on this picture, it's like sculptures preventing people to lay down or to sit down, and they're attached to private buildings and the public space. And what they did, they made a showroom for this, and the showroom, you couldn't enter the showroom, it was just a showroom to show these different objects, and directly relating also to the Fellini thing. Okay. And as a kind of going over to the new space, or showing, kind of contextualizing, I would like to play a little song.
But we're coming to the ZKU, you mean?
Yes, before coming to ZKU. Yeah. This was...
But we do that shortly, like Oliver, and then I would like come back to Rase, like short comment.
Yeah, maybe you can link up to that question. I was thinking, the topic of the discussion is disrupting networks or disruptive networks. So the idea about disruption taking place in these kind of processes of different networks claiming a city and sculpting it. And I'm wondering, because there is this similarity maybe, like in Berlin, you always talk about the special situation of the empty middle, like these places in the center of a metropolis, kind of in this phase of transition from one system to the next, suddenly being laying open and being open for use. And it might be that it's very different to the Riga situation, because you refer to this transition of systems and this opening up. So I'm wondering, to what extent would you describe your work and your interventions as filling this space with some kind of disruptive energies? Like we had this discussion yesterday in a situation where we might see that there is a kind of middle phase where there is a decoration of this empty space and there is some kind of wild flowers growing out, but now we are kind of in a situation where we wonder, will there be any disruption left, like once all these spaces are recuperated by these power networks which are now actually using them and finding them. So I'm wondering, how would you link up to this idea of disruption and leaving a trace beyond the commentary and the intervention?
Me? Okay. Yeah, it is different, maybe. When I was talking about emptiness in the 90s, of course, I was talking more metaphorically. This emptiness was in cultural system at all, like in all expressions and all systems. Because I think, by the way, that ILA was really the first art organization independently established officially. Because before there was just Artist Union, which was official, still left from the Soviet times. And And this cultural situation still in Latvia is it consists of very different small nodes where each of the small these nodes have their own aims, and this, but the whole picture together is very difficult to build. However, if we talk about networking, then I can say usually like for fundings we use like regional, Baltic, Nordic or European. But like local networking, we are more using for culture policy. For example, now is the case that we have established even such, like people in Latvia, we are calling ourselves, because we have the history of we like to be Latvians, to living in lonely farms. So we are calling like this, you know, you feel so separately that everybody feels that we have to own our own space, we have to have our own organization. And suddenly we have established alliance for cultural people, which really is a sign of some, I don't know, maybe it's a sign of democracy finally coming into Latvia, but it consists of cultural NGOs for contemporary culture, which I was also initiating it in 6 years ago. We founded such organization because still state institutions and culture are so much dominating that it's so invisible, the activities of cultural NGOs in Latvia, that I think we had to come together and somehow to make more visible our activities. But then also directors of state cultural institutions are not happy, and they have recently founded their own organization called For Time for Culture. And then the third of this cultural alliance in Latvia representing all these creative profession unions, which are old artist union, old composers union, union for writers and so on. So on this is like kind of the scene, and then because we have new government and new minister of culture from national party has coming, and during the 5 months of her governing, she has really made enemies into all culture fields, starting from the grassroots until the main state institution. That's something which never has happened. I even am starting to think about conspiracy theories of KGB, because she's from National Party, because the situation is at the point that we are nearly, like we had a meeting of this cultural alliance, but she got ill and couldn't come. But nearly off, we are asking that of demission of her, so nearly at that point. At the same time, this is very strange situation because Russia is next to us and always active and always interested into making provocations into Latvia. So cultural people are not good in politics. So at the moment this situation is confusing. We don't know exactly what is happening, how this situation could become so bad at the moment. Of course there's not enough money, but it's not really the issue. Yeah, so this is this one case of how culture is becoming active at these points when really some crisis are coming or some other like critical situation, then people are motivated to somehow put efforts together.
Normally I don't dare to disagree with Oliver because we don't do that. But it's not about disruption. We also wanted to talk about sustainability, and I think you now showed some ideas and strategies how to have these sustainable networks or making networks more sustainable. And I think that's also a question we're very interested in here. And you talked about this desire to have your own organization, your own home, your own venue. And I think that would be something Philip can hook up on that one, because they, as I said, have a new center for art and urbanistic that is opening in summer. And also in this idea about what kind of resources this city has to offer, there will be residencies. There will be residencies for art production at the interface of urban research. And I would be interested what kind of strategies you're using here. You can present the project a little bit, and what kind of strategies you're using to sustain this kind of very impressive network you already put up there. So if you look at the partners, there are like 4 universities in there, different kind of institutions, Transmediale, of course. But what is the next? You told me, like, do you have like a contract for the next 40 years or something for the venue? But what kind of strategies are you using now to sustain this new center?
Mm-hmm. So the first strategy we had to make up was getting the site and being able to have it for a long time period. So we don't have music in between, no? To leave it over. Shall we have the music or not? But how much time do we have anyways for
10 minutes left?
10 minutes? Okay, we don't. Maybe we do it in between then. Because I thought it's good to show a bit our strategy of how we want to keep on working with that piece.
So that
we have a look, okay? So that was a piece, it's called Land's End, and was in winter 2010, so from 2009 to winter 2010. And what you will hear is like an opera with five different voices talking about their own drama, their activists, their urban developers, their investors, and so on. And this is a short version.
Brandflächen in der Innenstadt dürfen nicht wieder bebaut werden. Städtische Liegenschaften sind für die Bedürfnisse der Anwohner zu öffnen. Der Wert des ehrenamtlichen Einsatz der Stadtbürgerinnen ist viel höher einzuschätzen als das Eigentum eines privaten Investors.
Stein fliegt beim
So the music was already composed, but what we did was writing a new libretti. And all the text, almost all the text, were quotes from other sources we remixed. So we were kind of, remixer. Where's website? Here. Zitko. So, but why I wanted to show you this is also because we are not taking exactly one position we would like to propose, but we would like to have the ZKU be also a platform for different perspectives on urban issues. So that's, I think it's good compiled in this Land's End Opera. So to talk about the new resource we could make available during the last 4 years. So in 2008 we heard about an open call for the usage of this space. It was published by Bezirk Mitte, and there was a plan to make a new public park. And that stage in 2008, it was supposed to be a bit bigger than it's now. It's now 15,000 square meters. And inside this future park, there were still the remains of a building of the former railway depot of Moabit. So there was this call, and we said, okay, we would like to take this building and develop the park around it over the next 20 years by doing things like we did in Sculpture Park, and some projects may remain and turn the park over many years into a park landscape. But that didn't work out because the money had to be spent within 2 years. I mean, they're still working on it, but the whole process had to be much more condensed. And so there were two different things. There was one like a landscape designer office doing the park together with the people, and us as the future user of the building. And this very official name, Zentrum für Kunst und Urbanistik, is also, you know, the Zentrum für Kunst und Medien, so there is some links to bigger state-funded large institutions, so we were also playing with this, because we didn't have any money, so we had to organize money to reconstruct the building. So it took us almost 3 years to get the Lottery Foundation to invest into the building, to turn it now into, we'll be having 13 studio apartments, and but that's not the only thing. We will also have a 300 square meter big hall. So if you look at the from the side, so we have the, this is a more public space, so it's like a project space, and this is the more residential studio apartments. So it's a kind of two-part division. No, not a roof terrace, but a big platform, überdachte platform. So because it was a train station, there were the tracks going in between, and but we will cover this, so we have outside a really large outside but protected space. Yeah. So this is also like going back to your question in compared to Skulpturenpark, which was very much larger project, like by size. We almost never paid rents for the Skulpturenpark. We just, as I said, we did it, and sometimes we paid some rent if we needed to. But we also didn't have any costs beside the interventions or the sculptures. But now we also have to, like, we, from our whole structure, we are more institutionalized because we have to pay every month certain money, and we have to get it in again. So we have no funding for the running the institution, but only for the reconstruction. Also the money is a little too short, so we have to also add other money. But anyway, that's a big, I think the big change for us will be how will we deal with this. And I think these strategies, as you asked in the beginning, they're now just forming.
But
there is an open call already for the residencies.
Yes, there was an open call for the residencies, which we got 140 people interested in staying with us, and we are now in the process of choosing the people we would think they fit well to work together. And as we said, it's arts and urbanistic, so what we're interested in is to have both artists working in the outside the institutional frame in the city, and also urban researchers, so from the humanities.
Good. So exactly 50 minutes. Should we open up now for some questions, or we are collecting them for the end? What would be the better strategy? I mean, are there any like immediate questions for the moment?
What do you mean the end? 50 minutes is
it? Sorry, but then we have the second part of the panel, and then we could come all together again, like the four of you and the two of us. But if there are immediate questions, I think we have still like 5 minutes. That's always this situation.
Yeah, but it's also bad because we sit here and they sit there. Maybe we should change.
Yeah.
Most of us are coming here from a situation where we're interested in also in a kind of critical approach to the technologies that really radically changed the world in the last 25 years. And in Skulptur'n Park, a lot of the positions where I would say kind of late 20th century artistic positions about space, you know, with a kind of origin in the 70s, maybe kind of renewed in the early 90s. I was wondering, with this, are you taking into account maybe involving media that deals with new technologies, or maybe working with artists or scientists who are working together? For instance, I can think of several artists I know who are both artists and scientists working with urban ecology, urban flora, but, you know, exactly this kind of a new approaches instead of maybe this kind of space-oriented sculpture that's very popular in German art academies, but is something that goes back to the 1970s instead of newer approaches.
What do you mean by new approaches, like planting? What do you mean by ecology?
Well, on one hand, we have here a lot of people working with technology. So technologies, digital technologies, networked computers. Then more recently, there have been a lot of artists who've worked with biotechnology, mm-hmm. or I've also seen artists who've actually gone and gotten second degrees in science, in natural sciences. And instead of using the natural sciences to maybe create a kind of art as entertainment, kind of art as entertainment, they're actually working on the scientific level.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, actually working with biology or with botany,
mm-hmm.
and then bringing it back, and maybe the artistic part has maybe more of a critical side that wouldn't be, you know, kind of a political critical side that wouldn't fit into the science context, but they try to stay very much intrigued with the science of it.
Mm-hmm. So the question is if we would like to work with them or if we...
Yeah, or how you're, I guess, trying to say is are you going to make a jump maybe less away from an artistic background that Skulptur'n Park had, and much more into one that either includes new media or includes art working with science, or where you see yourself in this split between, I would say, a good part of the Berlin art world, which is very 90s focused, and maybe some of the more
people. So you mean
here.
We are 70 focused? Yeah, because we are all born in the 70s, maybe that's why.
I see the early 90s, there's definitely a kind of scene of going back to conceptual art or to earth art and so forth in this kind of sense, and even in politics. And I would say 90% of the Berlin art scene is kind of caught in this redux. I thought, for instance, the Berlin Biennale 5, of which you were probably one of the more interesting parts of it, was very much on this kind of revival of conceptualism or post-conceptualism or whatever the trendy word would be.
Postmodernism is also a term, no?
Yeah, but it's kind of a dead term, you know? Mm. It's kind of something that's come to an end.
Yes.
And, you know...
Yeah, I think, we don't have the connection so much into like these people you mentioned, like science, biotechnology, but as we are also like with our partners looking for it will be dependent, like, for example, if we work with Transmediale, and Transmediale is taking also a residency over in Zentrum für Kunst und Urbanistik, that might be that they invite biotechnology science artists. But we ourselves, our call is rather to the or the humanities, like Geisteswissenschaften, so more in the analytic things. And as you could see in the Skulpturenpark project, it's more about the symbols and the imagery. So we are artists, all of us, and we are not so much coming from the science. That's probably why it is like this. But yeah, let's see what will grow from future collaborations. I would.
Just maybe if it's about this Transmediale slot, I mean, we would have a proposal because it's our resident.
Okay. Text and plan. Yeah, just to add to this your discussion, because I wanted, this is also what is from, we just looked to strategical side of the development in ELAB and RIXI, but we didn't look yet at the content side, but I just shortly will draw this line, because this is how I today could also see that the new media artists, well, artists who were working with emerging media in 90s, there is this one line that they were more interested into, like, also, like we were working in with virtual spaces, and we recently, by the way, organized interesting exhibition curated netart.lv from the 90s. We renovated works from the internet, somehow we also have worked with other networked setups. We have worked with Urban Radio Telescope, and this was in 2001 when we first time tried to work together with some art scientists also. To find some collaborations, and then this line, which I could say, which also this networked art from 90s, it turned to this mobile locative in the beginning of the 21st century. This those artists who had roots, who were starting to work in the 90s, they most of them, many of them, and also new generation came worked in the with the location-based media. But today I think it's what is important to talk. It is more about like post-media phase, because I'm coming from post-media lab, and today I cannot say anymore that this is media art. Artists are working with beekeeping in the urban environment. So they are exactly like you are saying, artist scientist. One artist I know from Austria, she is doctor in chemistry. And she's working with growing bees in the city as art projects. Yeah, so suddenly this or an artist Bartaku, Belgium artist here. So he also is doing like solar cells. He's keen on photovoltaics technology, but he's an artist, and he made even edible solar cell. So this was like his more like artistic contribution to this technology, that he found all parts how to make yourself. A solar little cell from berries, and to replace like a glass with edible jelly, and how to replace graphite with edible gold from India, where he found. And so. Or other different other like experiments with artists like window farming as well. Yeah, so these are what I really call post-media arts, where I can see the roots exactly from this line in arts that you were mentioning, which is coming from the 90s new media art, but today is not anymore working with this. It's more working like different other also sustainability issues and growing plants. And just to ending also my comment, I just wanted to show just the also our we have made recently an artwork which has planned communication network project. So we are, it's exactly, it looks like from the 90s, it's a networked installation. You can submit messages in the internet to the plant to encourage to grow it faster, longer, stronger, and more beautiful. Yeah, so in English, and now we also, for Postmedia Lab, we have also now programmed it into German as well. We will present in June in Lerneburg the project. So the thesis is unscientific that the devil, they probably even Arabic would like better because it's more melodical. So yeah. And it's very difficult today to say. We have like kind of switched our interest from information in 90s to energy field. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this probably is maybe what is actually at the moment happening, like in very interesting. So it would be interesting also in your residency probably to host some of these artists.
So I think we networked here and we moved then on to the second part. We're doing that directly.
And the proposal is, I think we can finish off this discussion thanking everybody presenting and also kind of this taking up this discussion as I think part of what Resource is about. And I mean, Raza mentioned the post-media perspective. I think talking and thinking about resources like we did yesterday, I mean, different genres of art and phases of art to us are different kinds of resources and currencies, and maybe we shouldn't kind of set them against each other or build chronologies, but we rather kind of try to make this a forum to have these exchanges and really link up ideas about maybe adding to your network new ideas which should fit, of course, your program for the place and your intent on how to cultivate this space. And so hopefully there will be some hookups after this discussion. And to make this possible, our proposal is that everybody gets some caffeine and water resource, and we make like a 5-minute break before we come to the more disruptive parts.